Welcome, 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 welcome to Mike on the Mic. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I know. Welcome, welcome, welcome once again. I say welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome, welcome to Mike on the Mic. I hope you all are hearing me. If you're not hearing me, comment below. We had some issues earlier last week and we had some issues earlier on this week, but with the issues out of the way, there are a lot of things happening and a lot of things have been changing in Trinidad. A lot of things have remained the same. We're still on a lockdown. We still have restrictions. We still can't go out. Tonight, I want to bring a solution and a perspective. The solution is ePharm, which is an online pharmacy. Good night. Those who coming in, make sure and share the live, make sure and share the content. I'm a small, podcaster, and my message is for a niche market. I am trying to build a community here on Mike on the Mic, and I appreciate all of you. Make sure and comment. If you comment, you can kind of get the comments on the screen too. Make sure and interact too as well. Good night, good night, good night, everyone, good night. We're still on a lockdown. We still have a lot of restrictions. Tonight, I'm going to provide a solution and a perspective. I did a story earlier on, maybe some months ago, with ePharm, and they had a very interesting and innovative service that they're providing. And I reached out to the directors at ePharm, and they were very receptive to give their message here. I see some people starting to comment. Welcome, welcome, welcome to Mike on the Mic. As you can see, I can bring up your comments too as well. So commenting to me is very important, getting the message out there. Reshare the live, reshare the broadcast. Good night, Racine. Good night. Good to see you here tonight, Racine. Racine was featured last night on Mike on the Mic, actually. She's a painter. She has her own medical condition. Now, Racine, tonight content might be good for you too as well. If you're looking for your medical supplies and you want to be safely at home, I did an interview with the ePharm director, Deepak. I just allow the live to build up a little bit before we go to it. I have him on the line, and we should have an interview with him soon. And once again, as I said before, my small community, please comment, please share your life, and let's interact, and let's try and see how best we can make tonight's show as interactive as possible. Comment, share your views, share your opinions. I appreciate your comments and your views. And I guess Deepak, yeah, he's ready, yeah? Good. He's ready on his end. So don't forget, like, subscribe, turn on the notifications here on Mike on the Mic. It's good to see Racine again to be inside. I hope we could bring more perspectives and more of you guys bringing my small community together. As I said before in the past, hold on to your seat. Mike on the Mic is up next. I admitted another hole got me finished. Broke my heart. Oh no, you didn't. Fuck sipping. I'ma down a whole bottle. Hard liquor. Hard truth. Can't swallow. Welcome, 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 welcome to Mike on the Mic. Once again, guys, I have Deepak on the inside. Deepak, to my audience who now tuning in too as well, introduce yourself to them.
Hi, good afternoon, Mike. Good evening to the audience who's tuning in. My name is Deepak Lal, and I'm a director at ePharm. We're an online pharmacy with delivery nationwide, and we also have a convenient app on the iPhone Store and Google Play Store as well.
So I reached out to Deepak because he has an interesting service. And as he said, he has an online pharmacy and an online store. First of all, for some context for my audience, where did the idea come from just to go all digital for a pharmacy?
So we were probably one of the few businesses to start during COVID. So the idea was conceptualized sometime around the height of COVID, which is March, April month last year, 2020. And, you know, a friend approached me with the idea for a pharmacy. And I didn't just want to do a regular in-store pharmacy. So we were looking at different features we could provide to be innovative. So this is where the whole idea of online pharmacy came about, because we thought that during COVID, you know, when everything is about spreading of germs and the virus and all that, we could have a nice, convenient delivery service, because I didn't really see one that existed in the market. So we thought there was a gap there to be filled, and that's why we pursued the whole idea of ePharm.
What was the hardest part about creating ePharm and having this, from going from ideation to actual having product now, being able to have this service for the audience? But before we go ahead with the question, Deepak, to my audience coming in, welcome to Mike on the Mic. Please share the live. It's a very interesting conversation. It could benefit you, it could benefit your family. We are offering more information on how you can get your prescriptions filled online. If it is that you're not feeling well and you're at home with this COVID-19 pandemic, a lot of people have been advised to stay at home. If you're not essential, you're supposed to be at home. But this might be an outlet if you're not feeling well to be able to get your pharmaceuticals. Yes, Deepak?
Yes, and you hit the nail on the head there, rightfully, Mike. That's the whole point, right? Convenience. You're at your home, download the app, your WhatsApp, the 48 Pharm number, and you get your medications delivered to you very safely. You know, you don't have to step foot outside. Going back to your question there about the hardest part of the process, as you know, the ease of doing business in Trinidad is quite difficult. You know, that's something we have to work on as a country. I must say, though, that I did use the TT BizLink service to register the business, and that was really quick compared to in the past where you would have to manually submit forms to the registrar's office. So that part of the process was really quick. You know, we got the name approved, registered the business. That was fast. Because of COVID and registering a business during the pandemic, you know, there were little delays in some of the various licenses. You know, sometimes offices are not working. You have to get appointments to go and register certain documents. So the whole business climate in Trinidad, you know, on all sides, it has changed. And it was a little bit slower than we would have liked. But I would say that is the most difficult part of the business so far, which was the registration. So far, everything is going smooth with regards to, you know, getting the goods out there. One of the other slight problems you might have now is because with the Forex restrictions and some suppliers not having goods in a timely fashion because of Forex delays and so on, that is causing some of the very popular items and in-demand items to go out of stock a little more frequently than normal. So that is a situation we had to deal with. So I'll say those are the two main things that caused some difficulty, but not a great deal.
And one of the other reasons why I reached out to you, Deepak, is the fact that you're a young entrepreneur. And what is it like adapting your business in this digital space as a young person?
I think it honestly gives you the extra push, because as you know, in Trinidad, a lot of things are done manually. So because we have no choice now but to operate virtually and remotely, we actually see in some of the government services migrating online, you know, like the courts and even, you know, some of the services they provide, like TT BizLink. And I'm now hearing that from the press conference today that there's a new online booking system that they're going to test over the weekend. So all these things have been catapulted forward because of the pandemic we're in. And what I like is the way to do business online. This whole push by everybody, and I'm talking about the banks, the insurance companies, even, this is the most amount of online activity you're seeing in terms of food delivery, restaurants, with all the different app services out there. This has really jolted Trinidad and Tobago into the online realm of business. And I think that is one of the positives of the pandemic.
And what is it like? What your customers' reviews has been like for the services that you provide? And once again, guys, who can all come into Mike on the Mic, welcome, share the live. This is interesting content that we have here. We're bringing you the e-pharmacy, and you're getting more advice. If you have any questions and that kind of stuff, ask the questions, comment, and we could punch up your comments on screen too as well, and we could get it addressed. Maybe we could have Deepak come back and even talk to you about other services that they may be providing. But now we're talking about the service that ePharm is providing. They're providing online. You can make your orders online. That's correct, right, Deepak?
That's right. Yeah, we have an app. So you can actually download the app, and you'll see our entire inventory of products. And you add it to your cart and you check out. And then also you can make it via WhatsApp. You just WhatsApp the medication, the prescription, and so on, and get it fulfilled via delivery, curbside pickup, or in-store.
And as you could see on screen, you can see the contact info and that kind of stuff. For those who may be interested, the contact info is right there on screen. Deepak, for people who've been ordering, and a lot of people are hesitant to go online, what are the safety in terms of their banking information and that kind of stuff? Because that's one thing that Trinidadians are fearful to work online on the online space. What can you reassure the audience who are looking in here onto my loyal audience?
So in terms of purchasing or payment, the payment aspect, we still deal with cash, credit card, or links. So when you order online, the goods are ordered online, but the payment is not made online. So at the point of collection of the goods, you know, we have the mobile or the wireless machines that can take credit card links, or you take your cash payments. So, I mean, there shouldn't be any concern there because there's no online payment per se. But what I can say about online payment in general is, like anything else, you have to be very careful. There are subscribers or subscription type services out there that a lot of them deal with a bank called First Atlantic, and that seems to be one of the major payment gateways in the Caribbean. And then there's a new one called Figaro. So I would say, just from a general perspective, you could look out for those two, and once you see it, it will be safe for our region, you know?
And all right, so let me get more into the process now. I'm online, I'm looking for you, I find your website. What's the next step, and how do I go through the process of actually making an online purchase with you guys?
Right, so we don't take the order via the website, we take it through the app. So if you have access to an Android device or an iPhone device, you could download the ePharm app. So you search ePharm in the App Store, Play Store. You download the app and you register. When you register on the app, you'll have various categories with all the products. So then you do as normal with any sort of online service. You select what you want, you add it to the cart, you click checkout, you put in your contact information, your address, and then you'll receive a notification that it has been processed, and then you'll get some guidance in terms of when it will be delivered, and that's it basically.
And we have on screen a kind of infomercial, I could say, of the correct, actual yeah. process. This is somebody, so they download the app, they're going through on what's available, and they make the order, and then it comes straight at home. When it reaches at home, what do you have to do?
When you reach at home, literally just pay for the goods. If you have a physical prescription, you hand over that document to the driver or the delivery person, and you just enjoy the products mainly.
And in terms of COVID-19, a lot of people are fearful of having people come into their homes and that kind of stuff. What are the protocols that you all do in order to be able to have everyone in the process safe?
Right. So, I mean, sanitization is of paramount importance to us. So all our drivers, you know, their vehicles are fully sanitized, you know, they sanitize themselves, they have their masks, they're observing all the COVID protocols. You know, in this pandemic, everybody has to do their part. So not only the driver when they're delivering, but also the customer, you know, we try as best as possible to make sure they have their mask on and, you know, deliver the goods with as less hand-to-hand contact as possible. You know, we sanitize the goods and pass it across to them.
And I mean, we're all under this pandemic together. And just to change the conversation just a little bit, because my audience, we like to have this conversational style. What has been one of the major lessons that you have learned during this COVID-19 pandemic as a person?
I would say, honestly speaking, is very hard for everybody to do the same thing and work together, as you know. As a country, we still, as much as the government and all the health protocols are going out there to be safe and take care of the population, we still have a lot of indiscipline occurring, you know, people not wearing their masks, people liming, all these kind of things, you know. So I think that was one of the major observances for me. As a population, you thought, you know, everybody would have tried their best to work together because it's a life or death situation, really, with the COVID. So that was one of the biggest observances to me. In terms of working together, I must say, though, that the entire community has adopted. Obviously, those people we're talking about, I would like to think in the minority, but the majority of businesses, you know, private, the public institutions, citizens, a lot of them have been following the protocol as well. So in the same breath, you know, it's hard to get 100% of the people on board, but I'm glad to see that. During the course of the pandemic, I've seen where there were points early on where nobody was wearing a mask when you go out there on the road. Then a couple of months after, you see everybody adhering to the rules. So, you know, as a population, I think it's good to see everybody out there listening and adopting the protocol. So it gives some level of confidence that we can hopefully come out of this sooner rather than later.
And as we wind down the interview now, all right, so I'm an elderly person. Can my aunt or can my brother, or my sister, my grandchildren make an order for me and I could get it delivered to my space?
They can, yeah. So basically, let's say for example, you. If you want to send an order, let's say you live in Chagones, for example, and your grandmother lives in San Fernando or something like that, right? You could actually place in the app her address and the goods will go to her. And one of the nice things we have at ePharm is something called monthly medication management. So for a lot of the elderly people, my grandmother included, when they get their prescription, they would sometimes have to fish around at a couple different pharmacies because, you know, one pharmacy may not have everything. So what we do is, because we have their prescription in advance, and this is something that they normally renew every month, we would have all of their medications stored and deliver it to them monthly. So it takes the hassle now from the elderly, which is the group most at risk during this pandemic, from going out there and shopping around by the different pharmacies to fulfill sometimes a large prescription that they have. So we offer this monthly medication management so they don't have to go through all that hassle. It just shows up at your door every month and, you know, as easy as it comes.
And I know you're saying convenience is one of the biggest factors for my audience here on Mike on the Mic, and you guys, we see problems in the society. I'm trying to bring solutions to as well. If you guys have content, just like how we have Deepak here tonight, who has a solution to you being at home and wanting to fill a prescription, he offers this particular service. Anyone who has any particular service that you think could be highlighted on Mike on the Mic, we could try to make that happen here. You know, I try to bring unique and different content for you guys, different from the regular mainstream media. But going back to what we were talking about here, the pharmacy, not just convenience. Is it convenience in terms of the cost factor too as well? Do you have value for the customers as well? Is it the pricing range? Is it like similar to if you go to a regular pharmacy? Are you lower? What is your price range like?
I would say the majority items are comparable. Obviously, we may not, because we are a new pharmacy, we may not be purchasing the volumes as some of the larger chains. So, but I would say most. The comparison or the feedback we get is we are comparable to a lot of other pharmacies.
And how far do you deliver throughout Trinidad and Tobago? Was it kind of demographic range?
Nationwide, really, you know. I mean, we've gone as far as Sangre Grande, Point 14, Port of Spain, Chagrama. So I would say there's no limit per se. I mean, if it's like, you know, Icacus or something like that, you might have to tack on a little extra delivery fee. But for the most part, nationwide.
And my final question, as we look to leave, and thank you, Deepak, thank you for agreeing to come in here on Mike on the Mic. As I said before, I wanted to offer you guys a solution, just like how I asked a question earlier this week about sleep, and I brought in a sleep therapist yesterday. People have been asking about their health. A lot of people have concerns about their health because obviously with COVID-19, your health is a big factor, and that's why I brought you on tonight here, Deepak. Thank you for coming on Mike on the Mic. But for my final question, as we're going out from the live too as well, you say delivery is one thing, online convenience is another thing too as well. Do you see this business model and this business strategy moving forward into the future as sustainable after COVID-19? And how do you advise customers in order for them to be able to adapt to staying at home and being able to make online deliveries and getting online services? How do you tell them or advise them to adapt?
So I think because of COVID, it has accelerated the adoption of this type of purchasing, right? Purchasing via app, WhatsApp orders, because, I mean, we've seen it over the past couple weeks in this phase two of lockdown. A lot of services now are available online. I would say encourage as much people as possible to go online and shop, because it minimizes the interactions you may have in physical stores. And we've seen, you know, a number of supermarkets and other businesses, you know, close for COVID sanitization. So it's part of being safe out there as well. In terms of the long-term aspect, I'm a person who always favors convenience. I mean, you know, I shop quite a bit on Amazon and make use of these Skybox services, because sometimes, you know, I don't like the hassle of having to go to multiple places, not to find out. So I value my time. So the time it takes to drive to each place, you know, to find a park, you know, the frustration sometimes. So I shop online quite a lot, and I would encourage people to do the same, especially during the pandemic, because it's one of the safer ways to practice. And I think it'll be around for quite some time, because as COVID has catapulted us into this online frame of mind, I could see people, you know, ordering their groceries, even their pharmacy goods in the future, because, you know, it's less hassle and more time savings for you.
And Deepak, I want to say thank you. Thank you for coming on to Mike on the Mic. Is there any questions that I forgot to ask that you want to be able to get that information to my audience?
No, Mike, I think, you know, thanks for inviting me, first of all, for this opportunity to showcase ePharm a little bit and talk about the pandemic. I think things like this type of show is important because a lot of people are at home now. You know, I would just like to say from a personal capacity to check in with friends and family. A lot of people find it very hard to be locked in home. You know, they have a lot of social, Trinidadians by nature, you know, are very social people, yeah. You know. They go out, they with their friends, they're liming, and to be locked home for a couple months, I mean, it's really hard for some fellas and ladies out there, you know, who can't see their friends, they can't offload any mental stress. So I just want to say on a personal note, to pick up the phone, call a friend, call a family, call a work colleague, check in on them. I've witnessed, you know, colleagues, my wife is a doctor, so I've witnessed, you know, people who she hasn't talked for years. They would just call her and talk for like 45 minutes. And there's no real point to the conversation, but you could tell that there's some strain on people generally, you know, with the types of calls you get in. And I would say do that civic duty, you know, reach out to people and help them, you know, through this difficult period, especially those who are not really accustomed being home for long periods of time.
Thank you. Thank you, Deepak. Thank you for coming here on Mike on the Mic. I had a phone call like that today. Strangely enough that you say that, I spoke to my uncle Neil. I hope you're watching in live tonight. If not, you'll see it in the rebroadcast. Uncle Neil called me earlier today and we were talking, and I realized we were talking for an hour and a half, but it was no real topic. We were just talking in general. And, I do agree, guys, we have the social interaction. This is one of the platforms that allows you to interact. Commenting to me is very important. I can pull it up on screen too as well. Share the live, let's build this community and let's move forward. As I said before, we had the problem of if you're home and you're sick and you want to be able to fill a prescription, this is the convenience. Deepak is offering convenience, most of all, helping you remain safe as we all continue in this pandemic trying to keep one another safe. Thank you, Deepak, for coming here on Mike on the Mic. And I hope you and your family future success and blessings. Take care.
Thanks a lot, Mike. Take care. All the best.
And that was Deepak here on Mike on the Mic. Guys, what do you think? Enjoy the content. Continue to comment. I noticed something coming after the director, studio director, everything in one. Concerning CDAP, we will have Deepak on maybe on our next future show, and I could ask him that question. But he says that it does allow for monthly prescriptions, the e-pharmacy. So anyway, I do have another guest on the line, and I don't want to keep him much longer in the background too as well. Rishard Khan, I work with him at CNC3, and he has been basically like the COVID correspondent. He's been attending a lot of the health and wellness programs that the Ministry of Health has been having press conference about. So let's go to that interview. I don't want to keep him on waiting on too much longer. I have somebody on the line here, so I don't want to keep him too long. As I was saying before, Rishard Khan from CNC3. Rishard, it's a year later. Welcome back to Mike on the Mic. How have things been on your end a year later?
Boy, it's been quite a year, and thanks for having me, man. I see that it has, in that year, you really step up the game with Mike on the Mic. I like what I'm seeing. It's looking really excellent.
It's evolution. We're all about evolution here on Mike on the Mic, man.
Yes, definitely, man. I definitely enjoying the new look, the new billboard, everything.
So, as I said, how has this year through the pandemic been for you? We kind of in the same field, but from different perspective. How has it been on your end?
Like I said, it's been definitely been quite a year. That's the only way I could really describe it. If you told me last year when this whole pandemic had now occurred that we were going to be in the position where we're in today with a state of emergency and all those different things, I probably really and truly might not have believed you. Especially because it looked like we were doing so well, you know, coming out of that Christmas period, and we saw cases actually go down to the lowest that it ever was since the second phase started. I mean, at some point in March, we had like 3 cases per day. You know, we were really, really, really in a good place. And then now, I mean, today, how much was it? I believe it was 500 cases or so we got today. I can't remember the figure offhand.
Yeah.
In less than 2 months. So it's definitely going to be a long journey again before we could even reach back to where we were earlier this year. So it's been a very long year. It feels like a lifetime, and I can't begin to imagine what this year ahead is going to feel like or even look like.
Wow. Well, and for my audience not coming in here on Mike on the Mic, please remember to share the content, share the video. We want to get the audience to grow. I like the loyal followers. Comment. Feel free to comment. I'll try to bring up your comments on screen too as well. But Rishard, has there been anything that you have learned from this particular year?
Oh, what I've learned this particular year especially is the amount of resilience that we had and have as a people. I learned a lot more about myself, and I learned a lot about the country over this past year. Like I said, the resilience that we had going on into earlier this year, coming out of the Christmas, I mean, it was amazing. It was phenomenal. I mean, even when the cases were low and I saw what people were doing, the mentality they took, and even coming now into this period of high cases, I mean, when just before the state of emergency, when the government had imposed some restrictions on us, stricter restrictions, and members of the business community felt like, okay, this situation is worse than than we thought it was going to be, and they took it upon themselves to even close their business. I mean, you imagine the dedication that it is going to take for a business person to say, you know what, I'm going to close my doors now. I'm still going to pay my staff. We really need to come out and do our part. And honestly, it was a heartwarming thing to see, because I know that that wasn't an easy decision for them to make at all, you know. And even though we're hearing officials saying that we got lazy as a people, we got complacent, and that's what causing these cases to spike and stuff, it was a really nice sight to see something like that happening, to kind of reaffirm that, you know, we're not a people that said that threw caution out the window, things low, and we're going to just enjoy ourselves. It was nice. But I also learned a lot about myself. I learned that I don't do well indoors. I mean, I myself have had to quarantine twice myself, because I would have had some flu-like symptoms, but it didn't turn out to be COVID-19, and the second time because I would have interacted with someone who themselves had flu-like symptoms, but it wasn't COVID-19 as well. Just being indoors, I understand what it is people are going through. You know, now with the spike, we're working from home, and it's a bit difficult. I was always an outgoing person. You know that, Mike. I was always one of those persons who always liked a nice time and like to really enjoy and spend some time with friends and stuff. And it's been a shift, you know. And then all of that, on top of having to cover COVID-19, being at most of these press conferences, always having to stay on top of my game, always reading. I read more during this pandemic than I did for my entire degree in UE, you know. Just always trying to keep on top of it, and then also while trying to manage some of the things that were happening in my personal life as well, it was a bit difficult.
And on keeping on that topic too as well, something that was distracting me before, and maybe we could address the audience. Yeah, you know, seeing the Baba again, or
the Babas and the hairdresser and all of those persons have been closed, as we all know by now, because of the increased restrictions and the state of emergency. And, you know, I could do it myself, I have a machine, but I said, you know what, I'm going to embrace the lockdown look. You know, see how long I could go with it, because I mean, back in my day, I had long hair. I know a lot of people don't know me from then. I tried to grow it back a little bit when I now started at CNC3, but I didn't have the disposition needed. So I had the long hair then, and I had the beard was around this length. But I say, you know what, let's see what quarantine, what this lockdown period brings. If the long hair comes back out and the beard gets a little bigger, I don't know, I might, this could be a new look. We don't know.
Yeah. I love it, Rishard. I love it. I love the new look. And sticking to the topic now too as well. I mean, you've been covering a lot of the statistics. You've been seeing how COVID-19 has developed. You see when we were in the low numbers and now we're in the high numbers as well. But a lot of people don't understand. I know all media people get a lot of licks online about statistics, about what's the reality. Some of people think we're doing false news and that kind of stuff. How is that mental strain? How do you manage to remain sane?
I just recommend somebody to remain sane, because I think I'm on the verge of going insane. Because like I said, at the end of the day, we are all human beings too. I mean, we do have a very important role to play right now during this pandemic. It's a very high standard that we need to maintain. We need to be factual more than ever. You know, we need to be crossing our T's and dotting our I's, especially right now. So it's a bit of added pressure with that, but it's we do try our best. I try my best, especially I try to read over things, and that's why I said I do a lot of reading on my own. I try to educate myself. I try to go above and beyond what is being said at these press conferences, what we're hearing on the news. I try to go above and beyond. I've read actually a lot of these actual WHO recommendations, the CEPH recommendations for vaccines. I've read some of their policy advice and all those things. But it does send you mad. I mean, imagine you, Mike, or even your viewers, and them just fed up hearing about COVID-19. I've been hearing about COVID-19 since January 2020, before it was even a pandemic. I've been covering that almost exclusively. You know, so what I try to do is really try to, I spend some time with my family. I mean, there's only so much you can do during this point in time, because I mean, I'm trying to social distance as well, because out of everyone, I'm the one who's most likely to be out there interacting with the public and coming back home, even though that's been thankfully reduced to an extent now with the state of emergency and our work from home guidelines at the office. But I try to spend as much time with my family, my puppy. She definitely gives me a lot of sass as well, because she's a very spoiled dog, and just try to kind of reconnect with the person who I was before all of this craziness started. You know, like I have my guitar and stuff in the background there. I haven't played it in a very long time, but it's there. I brought it out from storage and put it there with the intention to probably start back playing sometime soon. That's on the books for this weekend, actually. You know, so it's something that I think a lot of us need to really do it. We need to connect with ourselves mentally, spiritually, whatever your way of coping with things. You need to have that, how should I put it? You need to look beyond just staying physically well. We need to also look at mental wellness, because I don't know about you, Mike. I can't sleep.
I don't know if you saw my Facebook post, and I had a lot of interest. I had a sleep therapist come on MikeontheMicTT last night.
And that's excellent. Like, I actually want to watch that episode tonight. That's something that I'm going to watch.
And next week, I have actually going to have somebody who specializes in a sleep for adults. So last night, we sleep therapist for somebody. I did a story, and she worked with kids. But I'm actually going to have somebody who deals with adults and who deals with sleep apnea and other things. One of the things that was very, very, very prominent in the interview was the fact that we're not getting enough sunlight because of the lockdown. People aren't going outside, and that's one of the aspects. I mean, we can't go outside, but that's one of the aspects that may be causing the sleep, not having enough sleep. And then the cell phones, the laptops, editing for so long is our next aspect. And then one of the other major identifiers that she didn't confirm, but I think is the psychotrauma of it, of the uncertainty of what happened in the future. And to my audience member, please continue to comment. I'm seeing the comments. Please continue to share. I'll try to bring you up on screen too as well. You could tell us how you've been dealing with the pandemic too mentally, but I think the mental strain of the pandemic is real. You met my daughter. You know my daughter. I mean, it's very hard. I can't believe you're an adult and you're missing going outside. Imagine what's happening with the children. What are your advice for parents like myself or even kids who may be watching the live? What are your words of advice to keep them, I don't know, playing?
I mean, right now, the best thing is to really stay at home. But what I would advise definitely to parents is try and find as much ways, creative ways as possible to interact, engage with your children. Because look at it this way. This period in time, right now, this pandemic is historical. No doubt about it. It's one of the worst pandemics we've seen in a century, I think, since the Spanish influenza outbreaks in the early 1900s. Mm-hmm. So this is going to be a time that is going to define every single one of us, more so your children. So you want them next 20, 30 years to be able to look back on this moment and say, you know, the pandemic was bad. We were all scared. People were dying. But I got to spend so much time with my parents. You know, and especially before this pandemic would have started, a lot of us would have been so busy in keeping up with the day-to-day life. You know, you go to work, you come home, you're too tired to really do anything. You probably help your child with some homework. And that was it. That was the extent that you would get that real interaction with your children in. Mm-hmm. You know, make this time count. That's my best advice. Make your time count. Because when I look back on my childhood, I always say and thank God, I don't know how my parents did it. You know, they made time. Made time for me. You know, they always were always with me up and down doing everything, and I would not be who I am today or have the values or anything like that if it wasn't for that. So please, let's use this time to really reconnect with our children. And children, if you are at home, because I know you did ask Mike for some advice for children,
let
me behave like an old person now. Take your head off out of the phone, come off of the laptop when school is over, when your virtual classes are done. Go outside, learn to pelt a ball, run, play football, fall down, get an injury, bleed, probably break a limb. You know, all that is part of being a child, and you don't want to miss out on that. And parents, teach your children some of the things that you would have grown up doing. Hopscotch, skip rope, jump rope, all these different things. Teach them. It's a great opportunity for both you and your child.
I'm very guilty, Rishard, and I think I'll have to take your words of advice and integrate Nala into my thinking a little bit more. But also, too, with this pandemic and because of the environment and because the fact that it's airborne, I mean, a lot of times you go out and there are people outside at times. I'm so fearful. And you know what, I'm in high risk, so maybe I need to find some indoor games, not outdoor games, a little Monopoly or Scrabble, like long time, to be able to help. But switching gears now, you're kind of like the COVID correspondent. You've been attending a lot of the health ministries, press conferences, and you have been inundated with a lot of information. This week was probably the deadliest week since we started this COVID-19 pandemic. What was that like when the initial reaction? Because I could remember, I think it was either Wednesday or Tuesday, when I heard 23 people die, I was in shock. My pause raised. I was like, that was fake news. And when it was the reality set in, it really did, like, wow, this thing is so real. What has your reaction and your initial reaction been like?
To be very honest with you, it didn't surprise me at all. It's one of those things where, I mean, it is scary. I mean, in one day, look at it, for the past week or more, actually since May started, for the most part, we've had more deaths in one day than we had any day. Choose any given day, right? And we've had more deaths than we've had for the entire of our first phase of the pandemic. The first phase had like 8 deaths. You know, we're having double that now in one day. And honestly, it's not that surprising because I would have looked at the statistics, you know, reading. I read the report that came directly out of Wuhan that the WHO published with China. And when you look at the statistics and you look at the death rate, so now the death rates fluctuate globally. Right, but it's anywhere around that. Let's take a nice middle number. Around 3% of all cases are going to die. You know, they're most likely going to end up as a fatality. So when you see these higher numbers coming in, I mean, before we had low numbers. So let's say we had 100 cases. 3% of 100 cases are 3 deaths. But now, if we have 10,000 cases, right, 3% of that is 300 deaths, and we are actually below the average. For the world, I believe the last set of numbers that I ran was a few days ago, actually. So it would be the global average was around 2.1% of cases dying, and locally averages more around 1.8, 1.9, somewhere around there. So it's not that surprising, unfortunately, that we are seeing it, but it's a bit disheartening to know that we've reached that point.
Wow. And would you say that our medical staff has been the heroes in this particular pandemic? Because we've been hearing stories of people not using the bathroom for 8 hours, full suit, people just trying to learn to comfort. I want to say, you know, they are really like the heroes during the pandemic. Have you heard any stories from the medical staff that really like touch you in the most human way?
Listen, anybody, I firmly believe, and I say this without any fear of contradiction, anybody that don't or doesn't think that healthcare workers deserve more than just a round of applause or even just a salary increase or anything like that, I think something is wrong with them. What these healthcare workers are going through, and I've been speaking to a lot of these persons, I'm always trying to gauge what is going on the ground. And Mike, these people, I don't know how they are doing what they are doing. By no measure, I can't begin to imagine what it is they are doing. You know, I have relatives who are healthcare professionals who are on the front lines. I have friends. I've spoken to a number of sources I have within these various institutions. They're doing remarkable work. And from what I've been hearing, now let me paint a picture for one of these, just one of the stories I would have heard.
Mm-hmm.
They are going day in, day out, and they are so exhausted. They would have been on the job fighting COVID-19 since March last year, right? Many of them haven't taken vacation. Some of them can't even take vacation because they're on contract, right? So they haven't had a break. And when they have finished working, one of them told me, Rishard, sometimes I can't even get through my shift. It's like your mind saying go, you have to go, but your body just can't go anymore because you're in all this PPE. You're up and down, you're treating patients, you're just running around like a headless, well, not like a headless chicken, but you know how it is, especially with this surge on right now. And that their body is so physically exhausted that they're in pain. Another person from within Coover said it's perfectly normal at this point for medical staff to just go in a corner somewhere while working and just have a complete mental breakdown, bawl and cry their life out and come back and start to work. Because it's so exhausting. And then on top of that, they're saying that some patients, I mean, we've interacted with the public and we know how the public can be sometimes. And especially with someone who is on the verge of dying or even fearful that they might die and all that stress and emotion that they're going through are now lashing out at these healthcare workers. And they just have to take it with a smile and continue giving the healthcare, you know, and especially because they're afraid that if they raise their voice or try to correct a patient or even put them in their place, as we so like to say, it'll look bad. They'll say, oh, in Coover, they're treating people bad. You know, so it's a lot of fears. And they also have to fear for their families. You know, some of these healthcare workers, some of these younger ones, they still live at home with their parents, you know, and even though they have themselves vaccinated, you know, there isn't any conclusive evidence as yet to show that a vaccine prevents you from transmitting COVID-19. So there's always the risk that they themselves will come home and bring it to their parents, bring it to their loved ones, you know, and a lot of people use this argument, well, that is their work, you know, that what they're getting paid to do. I mean, okay, sure. Yes, they are getting it, but when you really hear these stories, sometimes the salaries that they are getting, what it takes out of them, it's nowhere near enough.
It's really, really a serious situation here we're facing in Trinidad and Tobago. And on that topic, Rishard, you've been vaccinated. What are your words of advice to the people who are out there who maybe have fearful for getting vaccines? Have any experience yourself?
I understand the fears. I will not pretend that it's not something that people have. It's something new. You know, we are so accustomed to vaccines taking a long time to be developed and that kind of thing. It's the argument that we've been hearing all along. You know, people saying that they're skeptical because of how quickly the vaccines would have been developed. But I mean, when you really delve into it, the science is there. It is safe, but I understand the hesitation that some persons may have. But look at it this way. It's a necessary risk, right? I mean, it's infinitesimally small that something good is going to, you're going to have an adverse reaction to the vaccine, right? But think of it this way. There's a small chance of something happening to you if you get vaccinated, sure, but there's an even greater chance of something much worse happening to you if you get infected with COVID-19. So I always like to put it this way. There are risks to everything that we do every day. Let's take, for instance, a police officer, somebody who has on a bulletproof vest, right? There are risks to wearing that. If you get shot while wearing a bulletproof vest, it's going to hurt. You could bruise, you could break some ribs, all those different things. But think of the alternative. You'd rather get shot and not be wearing a bulletproof vest. I mean, I'll take a broken rib any day than actually getting shot, you know? So it's something that we all need to do. It's not only to protect ourselves, it's something that we need to do to protect the entire population. Because remember, vaccines also protect those who aren't able to get vaccinated, because there are people who have legitimate medical conditions that prevent them from receiving vaccines. And by us taking the vaccine and hopefully being able to generate the immunity, we're also protecting them. And don't worry, I know a lot of people are seeing these side effects from getting the vaccine. It's nothing that serious. I'm not gonna lie, it caught me off guard. You know, I wasn't expecting the side effects to hit me as seriously as they did. I knew what to expect, but I wasn't expecting how intense some of these, the fever and the chills and the body aches were. But taking some Panadol, within an hour, the fever broke, the chills went, and I was back to normal until the Panadol was wearing off, and I took it again. And within about 30 hours, I was back to my old self. So, and it's been about a month, almost a month, 30 days since I've gotten my vaccine. I haven't caught it. I haven't dropped down. I'm perfectly fine. And I too had my little hesitancies about it. But I did all the research, you know, and verified research, and not those messages that come in on WhatsApp. You know, verified research from the WHO, the CDC, all these different accredited, verifiable organizations who have the brains, the money, and the scientists behind them. I did my research there. I knew what to expect. I trusted the science, but I understand that there will be a certain level of hesitancy among many of us. But trust me, I took it. You know, I'm relatively healthy. I don't have any underlying conditions. The side effects weren't that bad. I've had worse bouts of the flu. I got the fever, the chills, and whatnot. Yes, the side effects are unpleasant. I mean, if I had a choice between having side effects and not having side effects, obviously I'll choose not having the side effects. You know, no question about it. But I'd rather have those side effects, which only last a few hours, right, and goes away. Well, it went away from me with some Panadol. I'd rather have that than risk getting COVID-19, spreading it to my family and my loved ones, and probably be myself one of those statistics of someone who had an adverse outcome, meaning I would have died. And even if I don't die, there is a lot of evidence now pointing to lingering effects from a COVID-19 infection. You know, so it's a necessary, I wouldn't want to say risk, but it is a necessary risk that we are taking. I mean, there is a very, very, very minute chance that there could be some adverse effects from taking the COVID-19 vaccine, but anything has its risks there. Even Panadol has a risk there, you know, but I mean, it works. We haven't seen any deaths locally that can be conclusively tied to taking a COVID-19 vaccine. I mean, it's just hearsay. I mean, we're seeing it on WhatsApp and all these different things, but it's not been verified. Take it, because we're not only protecting ourselves, we're also protecting our loved ones. We're also protecting a large number of the population who cannot take any vaccines whatsoever because of different medical conditions. For instance, persons who are pregnant and nursing, they aren't allowed to take the vaccine. You know, there are some persons with some underlying conditions who are allergic to certain ingredients within the vaccines who can't take one. So if we all come forward and take the vaccine, we too can help protect them from getting COVID-19. And I know a lot of people are saying, oh yes, so they're telling me to come out and take the vaccine, but they can't have none. What are we going to get vaccinated with? You know, we can't get vaccinated. All that's well and good. It's a very good argument, but still, I mean, understand that, okay, yes, the supply is, there are some issues with the supply, but let's put ourselves forward to get vaccinated, you know. And that was also one of the big reasons why I went and personally took the vaccine, because I can't be telling people vaccines are safe, go and get vaccinated, and I myself haven't offered myself up to getting the vaccine. You know, I took the vaccine, and I took it right here, no magnet is sticking to it. I don't know where that video came out from on social media. The magnet, I tried. Just, I didn't believe it. I tried just for the giggles to see, you know, you never know. Be educated. Go to verifiable sources, and people, I've always been tried my best to be accessible to the public. You know, all my social media accounts, you know, I think half the country has my phone number. But at this point, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. You know, okay. I will try and guide you as much as possible.
And with that, Rishard, I want to say thanks for coming here on MikeontheMicTT. I haven't taken the vaccine yet, but as you know, I have a medical condition that doesn't allow me not at this time until there is enough research, especially based on my condition, because I have a high blood clotting condition, and there is a serious risk if I do take it. But I'm glad people like yourself are going ahead, putting yourself forward, and actually do take the vaccine and actually kind of help us to be able to try to see how best we could come out of this pandemic together. Thank you once again for coming back on for the year update. I don't know when we will be able to knock a little glass again with the lime. Hopefully that'll be not by the end of the year. I don't know. And given the statistics, I'm really unsure. 2021 might be written off the records in terms of socialization, but we wait to see. That's why this digital portal is here. Maybe we could do a virtual bay on a Friday. We could try that one next time on MikeontheMicTT. What do you say?
Once you pay in for it.
All right, Rishard, thank you once again. Thank you for coming here on MikeontheMicTT. Keep yourself safe, keep your family safe, and I hope to see you soon, bro. Take care, man.
All right, brother, take it easy.
And that's it for tonight's show. How has things been on your end? Thank you for commenting. Thank you for staying for so long. As I say, continue to share, continue to join me here on MikeontheMicTT. I'm trying to bring some more perspectives too as well. Take care for me here now, Mike. Feel free to comment, feel free to touch base. Earlier on, we had Deepak showing ePharm and the benefits of using the ePharm services to keep your family safe and to be home safe and still access pharmaceuticals if it is that you need it. Anybody who knows anything that we're having issues with them, but there's a solution and you think we could bring it in here on MikeontheMicTT, just message me, DM me, and we could see how we could bring it forward. I'm not focusing on the mainstream media, I'm focusing on alternative views and alternative perspective. Thank you for joining me here once again on MikeontheMicTT, and you guys take care from me, Mike. See you later.